Welcome into the door of psychic experience. Ask and you will be given what you ask for. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened. For everyone who asks receives. Anyone who seeks finds. If only you will knock, the door will open, and the truth within your higher spiritual self will be revealed to you. Come now with us, and go where angels come, and you can too. Welcome out there. Thank you for tuning in. This is Psychic Experience. If you tune into us, you found a very different place on your screen. We're a spontaneous, metaphysical, spiritual talk show, and we have very interesting guests who have things to talk about that you may never hear again anywhere else, but you could always have the opportunity to meet them another time. I am very blessed today to be interviewing a mystic who has been searching for God in his own way and finding out if there is one since he was 7 years old of age. He's been searching. His name is Armand Archambeault. I don't know if I said this right, but he has a wonderful last name. Some people call him Andy. He says that he has found God and his world is now inside himself. And this began with a 40-day fast that he had. He claims that he is to be nothing because he has had to become nothing in order to find God. So he actually says he started this with a 40-day fast. If I did that, I think I probably would die, but he said it was okay. And he did this when he was 40 years of age. Well, that's probably okay at that age, but I don't know about later. But since then, he is watching himself live life instead of just living it. And he now lives in two worlds, the unseen world, which is that of spirit, of course, and the physical seen world, which is our material world. And he has written a very nice book. I've been reading it, and it's really amazing. And I'm going to be asking him some questions about the book that I am so curious to find out about. Armand, would you like to say hello to our audience out there?
Hello. I'm glad to be here. I'm amazed to be here.
All right. For coming here to this studio in San Diego, that's amazing for me, too. So it's hard to get here. So we'd like to have you talk about your background a little bit, but first of all, I'd like you to show your book so that everyone in the audience can see what you have called it. And there really is a real, very interesting reason why he's called this book It. Because, as he says in the very first part of his book that I've been reading is that he's just decided that there's so many words that you could call God, he's decided for him it's just It. And that's what his book is about. So, Armand, could you tell us about your background a little bit, how you arrived where you have at this point?
Well, I was born in Manchester, New Hampshire.
Okay.
In the cold country, which I couldn't stand. And all the time I lived in New Hampshire, I was cold, whether it was summer or winter. Even in the humid weather, I was cold.
That's no fun.
And, yeah. So, at 7 years old, I was having my first communion in a Catholic church. Uh-huh. And this is where I had my first experience that made me feel inadequate in the field of God.
What was that?
I bit the host as
oh,
it was
did?
Given to me by the bishop.
Oh, okay. All right.
And,
you know, we're supposed to do that, right?
That's right. The nuns had told us not to bite the host. So automatically, out of fear, I bit the host. My subconscious just made me bite
oh,
it.
Oh, yeah, that it was like it was suggestion to do that.
That's right, yeah.
Okay.
And so I felt guilty from then on.
And
developed a search for me for the rest of my life to find God, if there was one.
Mm-hmm.
So I spent all of my life looking for God until 1970, when my life turned inside out. This is when I found how to read God through the Archangel Gabriel.
Oh, I was going to ask you about how do you communicate with Gabriel?
Well, Archangel Gabriel explained how it works, that he or she or it, Archangel Gabriel appears to be a generic form of a being, a translator of God, and a messenger between God and mankind.
So Gabriel's not male or female?
As far as I can tell, he's generic, yeah.
Okay.
He or she.
Okay.
Yet. And he says that, I'll use the word he, it's easier.
All right.
And he has beautiful golden hair that comes down to the shoulder length, mm-hmm. blue eyes like the heavens, like sky, mm-hmm. blue sky, just a trickle of a smile, beautiful face and skin texture. This is what appeared to me anyway, of a sports-like face,
mm-hmm.
wearing a robe where the sleeves came down to the wrists, like we see in the old pictures of angels and so forth.
Uh-huh.
And he says that he takes the pictures from my mind. We call those icons. What I remember in my subconscious mind is in the form of pictures. This is the international language where everybody understands pictures. So he takes these pictures from my mind and he places them rearranged in front of my forehead, and so that when my eyes are closed, I see these moving pictures coming to me in this direction like this.
Okay.
And they keep coming down and around, down and around. And as I say what the picture means to me, Gabriel continues to move these pictures. And when I do not understand correctly, he stops the pictures. And so it's a process of watching the moving pictures and interpreting them. This is the translation that Gabriel is giving to me from the realm of God. And I say that because I'll tell you some things as we go along that will show you why I have the confidence that this is from God.
Okay.
Now,
does he also talk to you?
Gabriel appeared to me in 1993, in February. He came to me in my living room. He stood beside my easy chair while I was watching Larry King.
Oh.
And surprised the dickens out of me.
I guess.
So, in a gassed form, Larry King's over here, and Gabriel appears here to my left. Full form, full figure in front of me, about 6 feet tall,
mm-hmm.
out of nowhere. Didn't mm-hmm. expect such a thing. I never saw such a thing before. And he spoke to me. He says, "I am Gabriel. I am your father. I am your guide." And so he's confirming what I had been asking through all these years. That, am I crazy? Am I seeing things? Am I doing something weird here, watching these moving pictures and thinking that you're telling me a story, and all these things seem so strange to me that they're unbelievable? So he appeared to me and reinforced everything.
He wanted you to see that there was some early proof that he really was. Yes.
Right. He was. It scared me out of my boots.
Well, you know, I teach people my psychic development class. They have a magic screen that's right behind their forehead. We all have that, but most of us don't use it.
Right.
He was training you how to do that.
It took a while because we had a session of several months trying to understand each other.
Mm-hmm.
For me to say the right understandings of the pictures and Gabriel to supply the right pictures in my mind. so that I would understand. So once we got used to it, it's easy now. I just close my eyes, and in 20 seconds, I'm one with Gabriel. Gabriel is showing me clear pictures, and I can read those pictures into language, my language.
Would that be anything like interpreting a dream? Are they symbolic, or are they just normal-looking pictures like photographs?
It's just like watching a movie, like moving photographs.
Okay.
Like time frames.
So you're actually like it's watching a motion picture.
Yes.
So that way he can show you what's going to happen.
And they're in slow motion.
All right.
According to my understandings.
Okay. So you've been communicating with Gabriel. Are you going to be writing a book about him?
I have written the book It.
You have written a book about Gabriel.
Yes.
Oh, that's it.
And it. I am finishing the second book now.
The second one, okay.
The second one is A New Understanding of God, uh-huh. Mankind, and the Cosmos.
All right.
This book here, It, is a diary of what happened and how it happened in my communications and my search for God. Mm-hmm. And this new book is an explanation of what was told in the first book.
I see. So it's a follow-up of taking people even further in your lessons that you have to share with them.
Right.
You know, I really strongly believe that knowledge like that needs to be shared with everyone, and you're doing the right thing. Could you tell our audience what you think It is? What is it?
All right. It is mind.
Is mind, all right.
Mind is spirit. Mm-hmm. And spirit and mind is what we used to call God in my world.
All right.
Many people use the word God still because God is a word for something we don't understand fully.
Some people call it the universal consciousness.
Yes. In this case here, Gabriel describes it as super subconscious mind.
Okay.
And I call it for simplicity.
All right. So what is the most important message from your book about God that you could share with people?
It is that we are all one. We are all from the same source, mind, mm-hmm. the super subconscious mind, mm-hmm. which we live in, which is just like the atmosphere. Uh-huh. Think of it as air, like the atmosphere. When you're born from the mother's body, you breathe it in, and you acquire the spirit to operate your body with this spirit and mind.
So are all minds connected together? We're all intuitive linked together because we're all God?
We are really all God. You said mm-hmm. it. We're really okay. all mind, and we're all the same mind. Except we have an individuality which is a responsible being in the material worlds of living. Mm-hmm. And the material worlds of living are all eternal. They never started and they will never stop. This is part of the Trinity of God, mm-hmm. the Trinity of the whole picture. Mind is the super subconscious mind. We call that the Father, we call it God, we call it. Mm-hmm. That's one part of the Trinity. That is eternal, never beginning and never ending. Mankind is what we call the Son of God. And we also call the Son of God, God as it is. God living in the material worlds. That's what the mm-hmm. Son of God is. And then the material worlds are necessary for the living of life. You need all of these experiences that we have eternally, never beginning and never ending and always changing. Mm-hmm. The material worlds, mankind, which is the Son of God, and the Father God, which is what I call it, mm-hmm. the complete mind, are three essential points making the one thing that we all experience all the time.
Uh-huh. Well,
this is life.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
I really was very happy about one of the things that you said in your book, because I began to think that myself, is that there's no such thing as the beginning of the universe with the Big Bang. It just has always been, always will be.
You can bet your boots on that.
It's eternal. There's no end. Back to some of the things that we were going to ask here. Why did you really decide to fast for the 40 days in 1970, and what was it? What was it like doing that?
All right. In 1970, I decided to do the fasting while I was working 6 days a week as night manager in Sage's Markets in Riverside. And I decided to do the 40-day fast because Jesus and the prophets did in the old days, and I suspected that there was something that was reasonable for mm-hmm. them to do that. They always seem to be sharpening up their prophecies, sharpening up their wits, and tuning into God mm-hmm. with these 40-day fasts.
Yeah, it seems like it. So what happened to you?
So I didn't lose more than 5 pounds.
Well, that's
I was already
amazing.
Thin anyway. And working 6 days a week, and all I did was take a sip of water to keep my mouth from sticking like it is right now.
Yes, help yourself to some my special water, distilled water.
And that's what I did. Just enough to wet the mouth so that I could talk to the customers mm-hmm. and the employees. I was the night manager and check stand manager at that time with 23 registers to check out. And so this was quite an experience during the 40-day fast where my world turned inside out. I started to see visions on the walls as I was talking to people.
All right.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Like I would see a vision in color, like a moving picture on the wall, about 6 feet wide and about 3 feet high. And it'd be like an earthquake and rumbling and people running all around and the rising sun behind Mount Fujiyama.
Oh.
It's very easy to understand the picture that I saw. And the next day, that same picture was in the paper.
They
had an underwater earthquake in Honshu, Japan, at the same time that I saw it on the wall. And then, besides seeing visions of present time somewhere else in the world, I saw visions of the future, like 10 days ahead, two or 3 days ahead.
Mm-hmm.
And these were verified by pictures and news articles in the papers.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So then you knew why those people in the Bible went to fast.
I understood all that.
They wanted
from
to
them.
See
yeah.
what was going to happen.
Yeah. Another experience I had was as someone was speaking in a class one day, a class of spiritual development.
Mm-hmm.
I saw a beautiful aura of many rainbow-colored colors, like pastel colors, about 2 feet wide outside of the body, all shimmering and blending in together and living alive. Then I knew this was the aura of the person who was speaking.
Oh, okay.
And then since then, I found out that the auras actually go out for miles. They actually communicate out into the atmosphere, into the super subconscious
mm-hmm.
mind.
Mm-hmm.
That's how the aura is read by the super subconscious mind.
Wow. You said something else that I thought was really interesting. Why do you claim to be nothing when you can have all this? How can you say that?
It's easy now, but it wasn't at first.
Okay.
I found out Gabriel talked me into becoming nothing.
Oh, all right. Okay. He did it.
And,
okay.
Yes. Gabriel suggested that, to think of myself as nothing, because nothing is actually something. Everything is in nothing. In the nothingness is where everything is. And so when I am going into the nothingness, I am going into the smallest particle that there is in the material world.
Mm-hmm.
You can call it an atom or an electron or whatever. Mm-hmm. The smallest particle, mm-hmm. and that's the closest you can get to nothing in this world.
Mm-hmm.
And the super subconscious mind, or God, is in this dot, one dot.
Mm-hmm.
Everything is in this one dot, and this one dot is everywhere.
All right.
And so by being nothing, I was able to access everything.
Oh, I see. Okay. Well, then, what is it going to be the title of your second book? Do you have a title yet? The one that's about going further with Gabriel on the lessons and everything. What is going to be your title? Do you have it?
Yes.
What is it?
It's A New Understanding of God, mm-hmm. Mankind, and the Cosmos.
Oh, right.
Which is an explanation of all of the basic things that are in the first book, It.
Well, that's a very powerful title.
And it is full of psychology.
Well, how close are you to finishing that book now?
I'm editing the book right now.
Oh, you are? You yeah. already? Oh, yeah. Great. Okay. Well, we can't tell people how to buy your book, but they can call the First Spiritualist Church anytime they want to. And, of course, our church's phone number is in the directory and all that, so they can call us if they're interested in finding out more about what you're doing and your book and all that. And I know you have a website, but we can't tell it on this show. I have one myself, but I've never said anything about it. So I am very, very interested in the visions that you have. Are they anything like what you have when you're asleep at night? Does it happen then too?
No, but many nights when I'm asleep, I wake up uh-huh. and Gabriel's talking to me. And I have a pad and pen next to my bed, and I write down sometimes a few lines, sometimes a few paragraphs, uh-huh. and sometimes two or three pages, because he's talking continuously.
Does he give you poetry too?
He works poetry into what he says, yeah.
Oh, I
he
see.
He likes
because
that, yeah.
I sort of noticed in some parts of your book, like, it almost sounded like poetry, very close
uh-huh.
to it.
And he gets a kick out of it.
Right, and actually the first or second chapter, I noticed that sounded like poetry. It was absolutely beautiful how it was said. So he's talking to you and waking you up. You know, that's what happened to Levi, who wrote the wonderful book, The Quarian Gospel of Jesus Christ. He woke up and was writing between the hours of 2 and 6 a.m.
Mm-hmm. That's the favorite hours.
Right. Because it's so quiet then and nothing's going on. So it's a wonderful time to receive communications like that. So I would be a bit surprised if you have a third book coming. I think there's three books.
If I live long enough.
Oh. As for someone that can fast for 40 days, I don't think you need to worry about that. You're probably going to live to be 95 years old.
Well, that would work.
Then you'd have enough time.
Yeah. I'm 74 now.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, I think that you've really done some amazing things here with this book that you have, and I want to thank you again for giving me one of those books. I also gave my daughter one and my sister one, and I appreciate the fact that you signed both of them for us. They're very much appreciated by everyone. I think that you're going to be teaching some classes out of the book, too, eventually. I really get a feeling that Gabriel wants you to teach something as well, and you've got another 20 years to do it in.
Thank you for the 20 years.
No, I just get a feeling that it's going to be about that. So the third book, I feel like, will be sort of like a teaching manual. And, of course, it all is, too. But I feel like it's something that you're going to teach. And a lot of people are going to be very happy because, you know, I was driving down the street near where I live in one of the churches in my area. They had this big sign up, and it says, come hear our lecture on what is your life purpose. And I thought, well, why do they need to go to something like that to learn that? Do you think someone needs to have someone tell how to do that?
You need to find what's inside of you and learn how to express it. And it's very natural.
But don't you think that some people overdo it by the fact that they try too many things, and they're really not getting anywhere where they should be going inside for the answer?
Right.
Yeah.
All the answers are inside.
Right. I agree to that.
Yeah.
Some of the best things that's ever happened to me is what I hear and what I dream about, because that's where I find the truth. I'm so happy you could be on the show with us. And we want to thank our guests that we have an audience for being here. He's very quietly watching everything. And I thank our crew. They do such a wonderful job. And we always have a little miracle every time we do the show. If someone can't make it, there's always someone just magically appears, like your daughter, Margaret, who came just in time to play with our funny computer that we have that does our credits. But I want to thank everyone for watching. And it's always a joy, and it's always so wonderful to do this show. And thank you so much. And don't forget our church. Write down the church's phone number, because you really need it to find out about more about Armand and our church. So please call us. Where angels come, and so can you. God bless you. Thank you so much for watching. Bye for now. Bye.